So I'm going to hand over to Professor Fred Freeman. He is a graduate of Aberdeen and Edinburgh Universities, and he was a senior associate member of St. Anthony's College at the University of Oxford. He's the author of too many books and articles about Scottish literature and Scots language and folk music and history for me to cite here. But some of you will know him particularly for his fantastic work in recording the music of Scotland, including the only ever recorded complete songs of Robert Burns, 12 volumes that came out from Lynn Records. And when I was at the Scottish Poetry Library, I remember the excitement with which that box set was greeted at the library. It was a wonderful thing, and a wonderful thing to be involved in, a wonderful thing to make happen, as Fred did. So we're very, very happy to have him here this evening with his knowledge of, his acquaintance with, his expertise on Hamish Henderson. And will you join him in giving him a very warm Edinburgh welcome?
It's a privilege to speak in this august building with the spirits of former fellows of the RSE all about the place, like Robert Adam, like Charles Darwin, like David Hume, like Alexander Fleming, like Sir Walter Scott, and I could go on and on. And no doubt, the spirit of one of the great figures of the 20th century, my mentor, friend, and colleague, Hamish Henderson. I shall begin in quite a serious vein, so don't be too upset, and I'll gradually lighten up, I promise. You who live secure in your well-warmed houses, you who will come back in the evening to hot food and welcoming faces, consider whether this is a man who labors in the mud, who knows no peace, who fights for a crust of bread, who dies at a yes or a no. Consider whether this is a woman without hair or a name, with no more strength to remember, eyes empty, and a womb cold as a frog in winter. Think it over. This has been. I commend these words to you. Engrave them on your heart when you are at home, when you walk on your way, when you lie down to sleep. When you rise in the morning, repeat them to your children, or else may your house crumble, disease undo you, and your children turn their faces from you. An upstarting point for a discussion of Hamish Henderson, for Hamish was the first to translate in 1946 Primo Levi's Shema into English. Levi's Shema, which radically changed the context and imagery of the Jewish daily affirmation of one God, which wholly transformed the language, the twice daily spoken atonement, into a moral imperative to do something about human suffering or be cursed forevermore. Both poets were concerned about a millennial conflict, to use Hamish's expression, whereby words in the wake of the Holocaust had lost all meaning, for a violence had been committed against language which, to paraphrase George Steiner, had become impoverished, empty, futile, much as it is today, I hasten to add. And if life is meaningless, so are art and culture. To quote Ezra Pound, when the application of word to thing goes rotten and becomes slushy and inexact or excessive and bloated, the whole machinery of social and individual thought and order goes to pot. How vital, then, to find a meaningful artistic voice. Levy's answer was to draw upon mythology, euphemism, colloquial expression, and Henderson would do much the same. If you add his drawing upon vernacular Scots language, no doubt inspired by a Gramsci who advocated Sardinian dialect as a full-fledged language, and we might also add a coarse folk humor to a typically Burnsian incongruous mix of linguistic registers. Take this short passage from Hamish Henderson's The Cell. Think and think long on all that horror, history's Saturnalia, the tortuous power webs, the boxes, the alcoves, the souped-up ideologies, the lying memoranda, the body count, the tenders for crematoria, the wire, the ramp, the unspeakable experiments, white earth, not earth. Consider the sharp juxtaposition of colloquialisms, souped-up ideologies, as against weighty Latinisms like Saturnalia, Saturn, December's unrestrained orgy, and sitting so uneasily with that other Latinate word, crematoria, underlining the whole hideously incongruous process. Moreover, the enumeration of horrors metrically paced like so many matter-of-fact items being ticked off an inventory list and ending in that last chilling image, white earth. Not Sassoon, Owen, Brooke has ever spoken of the horrors of war with such a strange, eerie, unfamiliar voice. The perception is alarming, is indeed a dual vision, revealing so much of divided minds, ours which cannot comprehend, the others which arrogantly allow the irrational and unthinkable to be perpetrated. Let's back up for a moment. Who is this man, Hamish Henderson? He was born in 1919 in Blairgowrie, Perthshire, one of the berry-picking centres for the travellers and itinerant labourers, and the wee bairn Hamish went along and heard their stories and their ballads and songs and what have you, and he gleaned a great deal from that. He died in 2002 in Edinburgh. He was a man, in fact, an orphan in his teens, who as a young university student risked his life to deliver subversive messages underground within Nazi Germany just before the war, who in 1939, as a very young man, goes on a self-appointed mission to rescue a young Jewish girl and boy out of Nazi Germany, right from under the nose of the Nazis. One day before Hitler attacked Poland, he could have been killed summarily. He almost was. He was, strangely, a pacifist who volunteered for action within the main theater of war in the early 1940s, North Africa. A mad folklorist, quote, a legend, the 51st General Tam Wimberley called him, collecting songs, ballads, and bawdry amongst allied soldiers and POWs alike, unifying friend and foe in the common cause of song, shared human values he could still see within the inferno of war. He was a revered captain and Italianist who personally, he was walking history, who personally accepted the surrender of Italy during World War II. In fact, he drafted the document that Marshal, Field Marshal Graziani actually read to his troops. And Hamish said to Graziani, we'll record it. And then he said, and Graziani said, dopo la mia morte, after my death. He said, no. He said, I'll give the orders. A captain telling a field marshal what to do. He said, okay, capitano. And he listened to him. Whilst Hamish composed his own inimitable songs, sung by the Swadis and partisans in action, like his ballad of the D-Day Dodgers, which is badly due for reassessment. It's a prime example of folk art. It's on your sheet you've got in your handbook. His artistic rendering of some fragments of verses out of the oral tradition, others by him artistically rewritten, restructured in the folk tradition as something altogether new. You know, there'd been a rumor that Lady Astor said that the soldiers who fought so valiantly in North Africa and Italy were cowards. They were dodging the main D-Day battle, and Hamish's ballad satire runs the gamut of moods, from light irony to bitter invective, ultimately to pathos, quote, the scattered crosses of those who remain permanently in Italy, 6 feet underground, the D-Day dodgers.
We are the D-Day Dodgers, we out in Italy, always on the vino, always on the spree. Eighth Army scroungers and our tanks, we live in Rome among the Yanks. We are the D-Day Dodgers, we out in Italy. Landed at Salerno, holiday with pay. The Jerry's got the bands out to greet us on our way. Showed us the sights and gave us tea. We all sang songs, the beer was free. To welcome D-Day Dodgers, sunny Italy.
Feel free to sing.
Naples and Cassino were taken in our stride. We didn't go to fight there, we just went for the ride. Anzio Sangro were just names. We only went to look for dames. The artful D-Day Dodgers, we out in Italy. On the way to Florence, we had a lovely time. We ran a bus to Rimini, right through the Gothic line. So to Bologna we will go, and after that we'll cross the Po. We'll still be D-Day dodging sunny Italy. Once we heard a rumour that we were going home, back to dear old Blighty, never more to roam. Then someone said, in France you'll fight. We said, no fear, we'll just sit tight. The windy D-Day Dodgers will stay in Italy. Dear Lady Astor, you think you know a lot, standing on your platform, talking Tommy Rod. Our England's... Sorry, say that again. Dear Lady Astor, you think you know a lot, standing on your platform, talking Tommy Rod. You England's sweetheart and his pride, we think your moves too bloody wide. That's fair, D-Day Dodgers, we out in Italy. Look around the mountains in the mud and rain. You'll see the scattered crosses, there's some that have no name. Heartbreak and toil and suffering gone, the boys beneath them slumber on. Those are the D-Day Dodgers who stayed in Italy. Those are the D-Day Dodgers who stayed.
Lovely stuff. Great stuff. Well, he was a poet who composed his war elegies in the thick of battle, rightly winning the Somerset Maugham Award for Literature in 1949, and constituting the finest, most moving poetry of World War II, to my mind, on a par with Sassoon and Owen. Though neglected by literary historians, he was recognized by Sean O'Casey, Eugenio Montale, Bob Dylan, and others. Montale, the Nobel Prize winner, particularly admired Hamish's Lament for the Sun, which was based upon a prose piece by Corrado Gavone for his son Aladino, who, along with 344 other, mainly young partisans, had been butchered in the Ardeatina caves. I've taken in my recording, I took a Hamish-like liberty of combining the poem with one of Hamish's piping laments, underscoring the painful image of the son and the father at the end, quote, a perfect and obscure cross, not a positive image of the cross, touching at one point and apart for all eternity. The Lament for the Son. He was the most beautiful son on earth, braver than a hero of antiquity, gentler than an angel of God. Tall and dark as hair, like a forest, or like the intoxicating canopy which spreads over the Po Valley. And you, without pity for me, killed him there in a cave of dull red sandstone. He was the whole treasure of war, of sanctuary and of crown, of my accepted human poverty, of my discounted poetry. You, once his hiding place was discovered, after which no angel could sleep, you with your thieving hands that were strangers to no sacrilege, you carried him away at the run into the darkness to destroy him without being seen before I had time to cry out, stop! Put him down. That is my son. He was my new son. He was the triumph of my betrayed boyhood, and you changed him in front of my praying hands into a heap of worms and ashes, mutilated, hurt, blinded. Only I know the tragic weight I am carrying. I am the living cross of my dead son. And that tremendous and precious weight of such great suffering, of such unbearable glory, becomes daily harder and more heavy. It breaks my skin. It fractures every joint. It tears my soul. And yet I shall have to carry it as my soul good, as long as I have one beat of love in my old veins for him. I shall carry him, sinking onto my knees if I have to, until the day of my own burial. Only then will we be down there together, a perfect and obscure cross. Why then was Hamish neglected? Why did he pose problems for the academics and literary historians? For one thing, he had two far-reaching radical ideas which saw him at odds with what he called the culture boys of academe. One, his belief in art as life, and I quote him, "Art for art's sake is art gone rotten, hardly worth the name at all. Literature, to be literature, must desire to be life, not an idea of life. I'm tired of reading poems which have an atmosphere of here is art." He said, "I want poems with the atmosphere, here is life, and this is Hamish Henderson living it." Shades of Rainer Maria Rilke there, whom Hamish so admired. Secondly, his belief in folk art, the oral tradition, especially that of the travelers and the poetry and song drawing upon it. He said this was high art, but certainly that is not received opinion. Hugh MacDiarmid, for one of our greatest Scottish poets of the 20th century, argued resolutely against Hamish and Scottish folk traditions, especially against folk song, in the 1960s in the pages of the Scotsman newspaper, and I quote him, "The demand everywhere today is for higher and higher intellectual levels. Why should we be concerned then with songs which reflect the educational limitations, the narrow lives, the poor literary abilities of a peasantry we have happily outgrown?" Unquote. He said great art was a matter of, quote, complexity, difficulty, the aim of all great poetry being human wholeness. Human wholeness, and that expression appeals again and again right throughout our literary criticism. Hamish would have none of this. He would throw Lorca and Gramsci back at him and talk about the integrating, unifying power of folk art, quoting Gramsci, for Hamish translated Gramsci's prison letters, and he admired him immensely. He said, "Folk song is a separate and distinct way of perceiving life and the world as opposed to that of official society." And with Lorca, he would make a lifelong commitment to the culture of the travelers. He said, quote, "Recording in the berry fields, in fact, was and is like holding a tin can under the Niagara Falls. So rich is the traveler's unique culture." As to the question of, quote, human wholeness, he argued, "Folk music and a ballad give us, as nothing else can, a conception of community in its process of change and development." That's precisely what Janáček, the Czech composer, was saying just about a similar time. A prime example, Hamish tracing the simple evolution, the integrating quality of song as it moves through the centuries. Moreover, he had profound anthropological answers to McDermott's elitist assertions about a lack of, quote, wholeness in folk song and the limitation of, quote, peasant cultures. As Hamish underlined in his introduction to his translation of Gramsci's letters, where he quotes Bruce Chatwin, I have a vision of the song line stretching across continents and ages, that wherever men have trodden, they have left a trail of songs of which we may now and then catch an echo. This is Hamish in full flight talking in 1951 about the evolution of a song called Sodgy the Cotton Spinners. Did you see the Cotton Spinners? The volume hopefully will be right. We'll see.
Sodgy the Cotton Spinners, which is a song of the 1848 Rising, is a song which has got its origins very, very early in Scottish history. Indeed, I think you could find words for this particular song from nearly every period. The words that come to mind most readily are the Jacobite words, Wha wouldna fecht for Charlie, Charlie being Bonnie Prince Charlie, of course. Wha wouldna fecht for Charlie, wha wouldna draw the sword, wha wouldna up and rally at the royal prince's word. But of course, when the people began to organise in the first part of the 19th century, they took the older tunes and they began to compose new words to them. And the version that's most familiar to the working class in Scotland is Sodgy the Cotton Spinners, which describes the march of the cotton spinners into Glasgow to take part in the rising. Sodgy the cotton spinners, sodgy them gonna war, sodgy the cotton spinners, marching doon the Bromley Law. Some of them had shoes and stock, and some of them had nane of a. Some of them had shoes and stock, and marching doon the Bromley Law. A little later in the 19th century, at the time of the Boer War, new words were put on this same tune when the 42nd Regiment, which is the Black Watch, the Royal Highland Regiment, was being sent out to South Africa to take part in the war. Wha saw the 42nd, wha saw them gonna war, wha saw the 42nd sailing doon the Bromley Law. Some of them had tartan trousers, some of them had nane of a, some of them had tartan trousers sailing doon the Bromley Law. And in the First World War, at the time when Scottish regiments were being sent out to fight in the trenches in France, new words again were put in this, which are not maybe singable in some companies, but here they are. Ya, ya, ya heelin' bastard, ya, ya, ya big Scotch whore, ya, ya, ya kilted bugger, knock him through the chateau's door.
Hamish in full flight. He was accused by the literati of frittering away his time with, quote, little poets at Sandy Bell's pub in Edinburgh, the hub of an international folk movement for many years, and was asked cavalierly by the BBC in 1978 if he didn't feel badly, quote, cut off from contemporary English poetry. He boldly replied, oh, I am cut off. I think I'm doing something different. I don't make any boundary between poetry and song. I write about the most pressing problems of all, namely those of our continuing existence. It is only the diminutives among the art poets who openly attack and despise oral folk culture. In an important essay, he would redefine the role of the modern artist in society, and I quote him, art depends on the society. In primitive societies, the poet or bard was an honored person, integrally part of the community. His songs or hymns were part of reality for the people. Gradually, the poet and the community must be threaded together again, and we must start here where we stand. He was in the vanguard in Scotland, in Britain, in Ireland, of calling for a cultural revolution, stating that the experiments, however admirable, conducted by Wordsworth and Yeats, had simply not gone far enough. I quote, "The time has come for contemporary art poets to renew their energies, not in debate in university seminar rooms, not in the pages of small magazines, but in direct contact with the folk poets. Intellectual inquiry is one thing, art something else." So, was he pulling two ends against the middle with his advocating combining art, poetry, and oral traditions? Or was he, apropos of our earlier linguistic discussion, developing a new poetic voice, a mixed voice, wholly represented of his wide experience with the travelers, with the oral tradition, with Scottish, English, and world literature and song, and his active position as a soldier in the field? Take, for example, his Banks of Sicily, which is in your handout as well, and I'll get John to sing it and then talk about it.
When I come round for his vino the day, the sky our Messina, sun cool and grey, all the brick chommers are eerie. Fare ye weel, ye banks o' Sicily, fare ye weel, ye valley and shaw, there's nae joke will mourn the kyles of ye, pair bloody swaddies and weary. Fare ye weel, ye banks of Sicily, fare ye weel, ye valley and shaw, there's nae hame can smoor the wiles of ye, pair bloody swaddies and weary. Then down the stair and blind the waterside, wait your turn, the ferry's awa'. Then down the stair and blind the waterside, oh, the brick chommers are eerie. Drummy is polished, the drummy is braw, he canna be seen for his webbing of all. He's beased himself up for a footy and all, to leave with his Lola his dearie. Fare ye weel, he dives o' Sicily, fare ye weel, ye shillin' and haw. Wheel o' mine, shebeens and bothies, her kind senorinas were cheery. Fare ye weel, ye banks o' Sicily, fare ye weel, ye shillin' and haw. Wheel o' mine, shebeens and bothies, or joke made a date wi' his dearie. Tune the pipes and drop the tenor drum, leave your kit this side o' the wall. Then tune the pipes and drop the tenor drum, oh, the brick chommers are eerie.
Prof.
Well, in that song, Banks of Sicily, Hamish was writing as a witness to the 153 Brigade of the Highland Division at the top of the square where he was in Sicily. In the aftermath of battle, the soldiers looking forward to a few days R&R. And here we have the multiple voice of the artist in the field, two poetic voices, two registers of language, a Scots ballad voice and a Scots folk voice. Firstly, the voice of the ancient ballad narrator, anonymous, impersonal, tragic, prophetic, the voice of destiny, what Willem Muir calls the underworld of feelings. It's haunting. The sky, our Messina, is unca and grey, and ah, the British charmers are eerie. There's more blood on the horizon. It's ominous. And secondly, the colloquial folk voice of battle-weary men, the internal voice, the communal voice, what I call proximity in poetry and song. It's almost conversational. It captures the whole mood of the regiment in one simple, reiterated reflection. Pair bloody swaddies are weary. Moreover, we have the voice of the folk overseer cinematically chronicling the actions as a participant himself, from the dozy fey pipey who walnut Cameroon the day to the chappie who's beezed himself up for a footy, ultimately to the voice of sad reflection, the collective voice that every swaddy is thinking and bidding farewell to Sicily. Essentially, they're thinking to themselves, now let's bloody well get on with it. There's blood on the horizon. Let's finish this battle. And conveyed, as with the old classic ballads, via objects, pipes and drums rather than undiluted emotions. Then tune the pipes and drub the tenor drum, leave your kit the side of the war. Then tune the pipes and drub the tenor drum. Ah, the British charmers are eerie. Wordsworth, in his prologue to the lyrical ballads, advocated a new poetry based upon, quote, the plainer, more emphatic language of humble rustics. The problem was Wordsworth didn't ken any humble rustics. The one time he was recorded as talking to a humble rustic, the chappie said, he spoke at me, not with me or to me. Yeats and Auden, to Hamish's mind, had, quote, experimented successfully with the folk idiom, but none had crossed the critical divide between subject and object, art and artifact, as Hamish was to do, mixing and milling, as we say, with swaddies and POWs, and then gradually leading a folk movement from his unofficial headquarters at Sandy Bell's pub, Edinburgh, or in living himself in travellers' camps throughout much of his life. Hamish had made a conscious decision which, in the narrow world of the arts, would cost him dearly when he insisted, my commitment was to the oral tradition. The choices were success at my desk or failure in the berry fields. I chose the drills, the quick work of Blair Gowrie and with the Stuarts, with the travellers. In a philosophical argument, he said the Stuarts, the travellers, reminded him of the most fundamental questions of life and art. Who are we? Where do we come from? Where are we going? He said the travellers and their mode of life made him aware, quote, of the dualities of existence, the dualities of existence. In fact, these dualities were central to another radical idea, his notion of hybrids. Man himself, man, women, were fundamentally hybrids, as Bond says in so many of his letters, men, women, poised between being beasts and aspiring angels. Hamish said, you know something, that's not so bad. That's not such a bad thing. In fact, he said, Scotland's social and cultural strength lay in its constant flux, its variety, its hybridized nature. It's no accident that Gramsci himself, in one of the letters Hamish chose to translate, asserts, modern man ought to be a synthesis of the qualities which are traditionally embodied in various national characters, not just one thing. Hamish encouraged hybrids quite directly. And he used to scare the hell out of me because I would go by his flat and he would place in something irreplaceable in my hand. One time I went by of a morning to see him and he placed in my hand a tape he'd just received from the American singer Pete Seeger, attempting to sing his Freedom Come All Ye I in a synthetic Scots necessarily, but the whole experience of that bridged the cultural gaps that the song was not designed to bridge. Here's Pete Seeger singing a bit, just a snippet, not in great voice, as he says, of Hamish's Freedom Come All Ye. Just a snippet of it.
Hamish, this is Pete Seeger, 5 a.m., going to try to record for you your own song, The Freedom Come All Ye, in my tattered voice, in the hopes that you'll have time to listen to it and correct my pronunciation and also give me the correct Scottish Gaelic word for cherry tree.
Not Gaelic, Scots. Never mind.
Anyway, here goes. Rach the wind, thraw the clar day's dawn, blows the clouds, heels the gary o'er the bay. Yet there's mair nor a rough wind blowing through the great glen of the world the day. It's a thought that can gar o'er rattans, ah, the rogues that gang gallus fresh and gay. Tak the roar and seek their loanings, for their ill ploys to sport and play.
Furthermore, the idea of duality, constant flux, meant to his mind a specific burden of discernment, engagement with everyday life, art as life or as death, you might say. In fact, he freely chose to cast himself into the maelstrom of World War II. As he says in his 10th elegy, the choice was simple. Either build for the living love, patience, and power to absolve these tormented, or else choke in the folds of their black-edged vendetta. He states this so eloquently in a song about what he later dubs those, quote, twin dragons, life and death, in a song we've come to know as The Flighting of Life and Death, which we won't do right now. I won't lumber John with that. Or in his a more finely distilled ballad, The Speaking Heart, which should be better known, a poignantly dramatic representation of Bonds' duality of man, woman as beast and angel, blind bestiality of the son and the undying love of the mother, The Speaking Heart, which is indeed in your handout.
Your lad Jens and a lad Citrum, hi the haw, the galley floor, hi the tide.
That bit you can sing.
Your lad Jens and a lad Citrum, ye lewd alas, wha lewd na him. Fetch to me a rogue. Hi the haw, the galley floor, hi the time. Says she, fetch to me a rogue. Your mother's hurt for to feed my dog. Mother's who's get this young man. Hi the haw, the galley floor, hi the time. 'Tis mother's who's get this young man. And he cut out her heart, and awa he ran. As he ran, he tripped and fell. Hi the haw, the galley flew high the time. As he ran, he tripped and fell, and the hurt rode on the ground as well. The hurt was greeting, the hurt it stoted again the stain. High the haw, the galley flew high the time. The hurt it stoted again the stain. The laddie heard it makin' its mane. Greeting and crying foo small. Hi the haw, the galley flew high the time. The hurt was greeting and crying foo small. Are you hurt, my bairn? Are you hurt at all? Dear lad Jens and lad Citram, high the haw, the galley flew high the time. Dear lad Jens and lad Citram, he looed alas while looed naam.
Stuff. Let's look again at duality as applied to language, poetic voice in his art. Hamish had no illusion about fascist responsibility for genocide. In fact, as he once stated in a letter to the Scotsman, freedom is never but never a gift from the above. It has to be won anew by its own exercise. He avowedly set out to save the Jews and other minorities of Europe in his own person, insofar as one man could even think of doing that. He did say if he'd known what was happening in the extermination camps of the East, he would have fought even harder. He deplored the brutality of the German SS. In his battlefield notebooks, he jots down in verse, "For the sadist and the slayer, the flogger and the slave, for them will say no prayer, for them will dig no grave. If all lay swollen, rotten, black on the German plain, the pure sky they'd forgotten, its tears of joy would rain." Yet during the fray and afterwards, he says we should, quote, not disfigure ourselves with villainy of hatred. He talks sympathetically of the Germans as the oppressors, the unity of all in, quote, des proletariat. Such a tension, a duality, is at the core of his ninth elegy, where he personalizes humanely the feelings and the whole experience of war through two projections within his own mind, representing two soldiers, a dead German and a pretty knackered Scots swaddy, whose mix of thoughts expressed both sympathy and condemnation for the young German. And Hamish characteristically reverts to linguistic duality, two registers of speech corresponding to one, the objective artist and diarist in the field, which he most certainly was, and secondly, the soldier in the field, which he also was. One, a distant voice, monumental, like Sassoon, as he speaks formally of, quote, a fallen enemy, of pietas, piety, patriotism, in the idiom of the World War I poets, cold, remote, images chiseled in stone and words up and down the country. For that reason, images in danger of losing all meaning. Another voice, a second voice, is almost too intimate. It's coarse, we would say. Ungrammatical, the colloquy of the pub, shebeen, the language of the common swaddy in the field, his surrogate self setting into relief, personalizing his innermost feelings of disdain and pity for the dead German. Poor mucker, silly bastard. Yes, the only good Jerry, as they say, is your sort, chum. Cheerio, you poor bastard. The ninth elegy. Fort Capuzzo, for there will come a day when the Lord will say, close order. One evening, breaking a jeep journey at Capuzzo, I noticed a soldier as he entered the cemetery and stood looking at the grave of a fallen enemy. Then I understood the meaning of the hard word pietas, a word unfamiliar to the newsreel commentator as well as to the pimp, the informer, and the traitor. His thought was like this. Here's another good Jerry. Poor mucker, just 18. Must be hard up for manpower, or else he volunteered, silly bastard. That's the fatal mistake. Never volunteer for nothing. I wonder how he died. Just as well it was him, though, and not one of our chaps. Yes, the only good Jerry, as they say, is your sort, chum. Cheerio, you poor bastard. Don't be late on parade when the Lord calls close order. Keep waiting for the angels. Keep listening for reveille. Much of his poetry focuses on a painful dialogue, a duality within himself, where he bravely challenges his own socialist principles, quote, doom of the dialectic weighed up and found wanting. Like Primo Levi, he will bear, quote, witness, and how like Levy, his own soul-searching in the aftermath of war, when he says of the dead soldiers sacrificed on the battlefield, there sleeps our unrest, we lie bound in their inferno, this alliance must be vaunted and affirmed, lest they condemn us. Part of the duality, Hamish so admired in The Travellers and in folk art generally, is the absurd surrealism that we find in the ballads. And it's what I call a strange balance of worlds. We see it in Dunbar, we see it in Henderson, we see it right through Ferguson and Burns, etc. There's a lovely traditional story that Hamish used to quote about a Presbyterian divine preaching to his congregation on the pains of hell and assuring them so consolingly, and it's there you will find yourselves after all your sinful and carnal lives that come to an end, turning and twisting and groaning on the fires of hell, and you will be crying out to the Almighty, Lord, we didn't ken, we didn't ken. And the Lord, in his infinite mercy and compassion, will look down and say, aye, well, you can know. There is embedded in all this daftness a very Scottish perspective, at times a ridiculous mix of worlds, mundane and divine, everyday and otherworldly, a means of coping with anxiety and suffering, and it's there in our literary tradition in Scots from the outset, as I say, the ballads, Henderson, Dunbar, Burns, and I could go on, Hamish. A great example, Hamish recorded a song from one of the travellers who'd been shot to pieces four times in the Great War, David Stewart, invalided out four times in his area. They couldn't even form, as with so many, a pipe band, shot to pieces, and he carried this particular ballad, part of which he probably wrote. Hamish collected it, I transcribed it, and I recorded it in 2005 with the late Jim Reid on an album called Yaunt the Tay. It's on your sheet, I think, there. It's called Donald Was a Piper. I'll play this. I couldn't put John through this, but it's grand. It's from our 2005 recording. Daft Donald, it's called. Thank you.
Connell was a piper, a 14-18 piper, hyper, a heeper, a ho, para hari. Life's a chillin' him, for he had been a diker, hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. Donald went to war, the German for to slew man, hyper, a heeper, a ho, para hari. But he got surrounded just before he knew man, hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. So he blew up the bagpipes and blew an awful blaman. Hi, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. Germans got so scared, they are on a woman. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. Michen, mehi, 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 mahami. Hi, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. Ed, para, muscle, para, Aberdeen, hadi. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. But the German bullet hit him in a place I can't say, man. Hi, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. The chanter got an extra hole, the bag, it blew a woman. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. They put him in a van, the hospital they brought him. Hi, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. Put him in a bed and sent for the doctor. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. Mehin, mehi, 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 mehami. Hai, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. Edin, para, muscle, para, Aberdeen, hadi. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da. Donald same again, knew the war has ended. Hai, para, hi, para, ho, para, hari. He play for you a tune when they get the backpipe mended. Hochen, dochen, hechen, dochen, hechen, dochen, da.
Well, what's the point of all that daftness, you might ask? In a word, sanity. It's one means of coping with, say, over a million soldiers killed in the Battle of the Somme alone. Hamish himself, in the midst of the chaos and destruction of war, develops what he calls a demonic energy, a wicked wit. And here again, in this context, a new poetic voice. He once referred in a letter to the Daily Worker to Picasso's fauns and centaurs for embodying, quote, the ancient wisdom disguised as laughter. In his own inimitable way, his surrealistic humor does precisely that. It undermines absolute order, systems that control men and women. Like his splendid, unknown version of the great battle of El Alamein, reminding us all of the duality of human existence, crudely physical and spiritual. This is Hamish in one of the worst battles in history. El Alamein, the corpses all over the place, white crosses here and there where they had time to bury them, the detrituses of war, cannons all over the place, a barrage that went on for hours upon hours upon hours. Hamish's account right here. I've tried to give some idea of what I felt at that moment in interlude, opening of an offensive between two halves of elegies for the dead in Cyrenaica. But nothing could possibly recapture the appalling din of the artillery barrage, which made the earth throb and shudder in what seemed like a veritable apocalypse now, or indeed a heart of darkness. If the barrage stunned even our own troops, wrote Major H. Gillen of the 9th Australian Division, and the ground vibrated under our feet like the skin of a kettle drum. Indeed, the jaw-breaking battering of the gun seemed to me to be landing blow after blow on one of my molars, for by 10 o'clock I had a raging toothache, which admittedly took my mind off everything else that was happening. Indeed, needless to say, I had to thole it, endure it for days on end until the 27th. I got leave to commandeer a truck and driver and make for the, quote, field dentist 4 or 5 miles back from the line. Inside, when I arrived, the field dentist was operating what looked like a Victorian knife grinder's appliance, churning away with his right foot while he drilled a hole in a victim's tooth, the victim looking like a damn soul straight out of Anonymous Bosch. Beside him, his assistant was mixing a filling on a tin plate while desert sand flew all over the place, no doubt adding some local color to the filling. I remember thinking that this was one of the horrors of war that wouldn't find its way onto the newsreels. Next, please. I went in and sat on a rickety field chair. As always happens, my toothache had been banished completely by the sight described above, but there was nothing for it but to dream a weird, endure my fate. What's wrong then? I indicated a molar on the right-hand bottom tier of my jaw and requested him to extract it. After a brief inspection, the field dentist assured me that he could save it. This was the last thing I wanted to hear. And I practically beseeched him to lug it out, but no, it would be a shame. It was eminently savable, and out of the corner of my eye, I could see his right foot moving towards the knife grinder's appliance. Bloody hell! But the field dentist was OC, his own little show, and had one more pip on his shoulder than I had. Clearly, there was no alternative but to sit back and think of Scotland. However, he was as good as his word. He well and truly saved a molar, and I retained it in my mouth until 1957 when I was up north recording the Highland Stewarts. I asked the Inverness dentist to give it me as a souvenir, which he did, and I still have it somewhere, no doubt, with a few grains of desert sand to authenticate. It's completely mad. He would carry into battle this mad humor and art, this creative energy, his own way of jamming the death machine, writing himself those, quote, blustering, unkillable songs. He uses a black humor for what the Russian formalists later would call defamiliarization, highfalutin word, setting his serious points into relief with a wicked wit. To quote Carl Burkhardt, the Swiss cultural historian, in order to be truly expressive, the word in poetry must first become strange, like Levy, like Hamish Henderson. Out of this, his own poetry develops into a dynamic, irrepressible blend of life-giving folk humor in the midst of the inferno. He creates humorous and human touches few poets ever achieve, providing a strange new context for expressing passionate thought. So another poem I would recite, but I'm looking at my time and it's moving on. So it's a poem called So Long. If you have the album or something, you corner me, I'll recite it. So, a new modern Scottish voice, folk and art together, or perhaps a more a voice of cultural continuity. For in his foreword to the Second People's Festival, he reflects, throughout Scottish history, there has been a constant interplay between the folk tradition and the learned literary tradition, an interplay more constant and fruitful with us than in the literatures of most other European countries. If the Renaissance in Scottish arts and letters is to be carried a stage further, our poets and writers could maybe do worse than go to school with the folk singers, unquote. And this hybridized nature of the Scottish tradition was for him part of a cultural continuum running right throughout our history in Scotland and carried forward over centuries by the folk and the oral tradition. This natural duality in the Scottish tradition of song was an embodiment of Gramsci's, quote, creative clash of contradictions. In Scottish literature and music, Hamish cites a creative synthesis of art and oral traditions wholly central to Scots folk culture and art. There is, to quote him, a curious and perhaps unique collaboration over the centuries between the non-literate ballads of the travellers and the individual creative efforts of sophisticated literary characters like Scott and Hogg, who were close to the rural springs of Scots folk culture. Furthermore, he recognized the potential for revitalizing the modern Scots literary and musical tradition through returning to this unique creative duality. As he said, literature must once again be in direct contact with the folk poets. And here we return to McDermott and Edwin Muir, whom I admire if he's looking down. Edwin Muir's artistic challenge of achieving, quote, wholeness in art. Muir notably cites a creative wedge between thought and feeling in modern Scottish verse, and indeed in our psyche, an inherent problem within Scots language itself because of its fragmented history, especially after the Reformation, the Union of Crowns in 1603, the 1707 Union, which precluded, quote, the requisite fullness and variety of association which makes poetic expression transcendent as it is in the English literary tradition, to paraphrase a bit of him. In fact, Hamish would turn these naysaying arguments on their head, actually writing Edwin Muir to assure him that he was mistaken. quote, I'm inclined to think that the folk poetry of Scotland is superior to most art poetry. I'm sure now that nothing should be said about the language problem facing Scottish writers until an exhaustive study has been made of the language of the old anonymous folk poetry. Hamish, more than any other cultural spokesman, and we've plenty of, I'll get myself into trouble, plenty of Scots language societies, but I mean, Hamish is the one that I turn to again and again because he's the only one who's put the whole thing together. He said he turns the arguments of the Scots folk song and Scots language decriers on their head, citing the strength of the mixed linguistic tradition of the ballads. In this respect, the whole unhomogeneous Scots language tradition of historical flux and fragmentation becomes, like Yiddish for Isaac Bashevis Singer, a tremendous strength, not a weakness, a subtle, what Hamish called a subtle, supple instrument of expression, as he has it, presenting the human condition writ large. Look at the situation today. Is it nice and homogeneous? I don't think so. He said, Ballad Scots is a flexible formulaic language which grazes Ballad English and yet is clearly identifiable as a distinct folk literary lingo. It admirably manifests a curious bilingualism in one language which greatly extends its range and demonstrably makes it a much suppler instrument than the rather wooden Ballad English. It goes on and on, almost but saying, and it'd be historically accurate that English is a dialect of Scots rather than the other way around. He would castigate the rejection of folk culture, insisting that it not only embodied ideas counter to those of learned culture, but it was in many aspects an explicit challenge to the ruling class way of looking at the world. I could go, I'm chewing up the clock, but I have a few more minutes yet. Moreover, those from Margaret Laidlaw to 20th century purists and naysayers who insisted that the printed word, the radio, the tape machine, the LP, the cinema, the TV would destroy folk song. He would go onto the computer if he were around. He disagreed with them vehemently. He cited wonderful examples of Callum MacLean, the founder of the School of Scottish Studies, going off to the Isles of Barra and Eriskay, collecting walking songs, the bleaching of the Tweed, and teaching them a week later to all sorts of metropolitan folk from London and everywhere else, and they were singing them in an oral tradition again. So to the argument of the ultimate demise of folk culture, I've aptly dubbed this Henderson's third law. Folk culture can neither be created artificially nor destroyed. And that's what he says essentially. He argued that folk song was in Scots high art. I would play an example from Jeannie Robertson, have a listen to her sometime, like my son David. I won't play that. But what I will play, Hamish didn't study the travelers looking at them through a microscope. He didn't believe in that. He was part and parcel of their culture. He gave them as much as they gave him. Whenever I mention that Hamish sang mouth music and all that, people say, where did you get that? Well, there are plenty of recordings of it. Here's Hamish singing a bit of mouth music that he would sing around the travelers' camps when he stayed with them. We're getting there, John. Try that sometime. John's trying it. Academically, he complained of the, quote, somewhat mechanistic structuralist analysis of folk literature now so much to the fore. He hated it. We had discussions about this plenty of times. I could cite some stories, but I'd have to cite them privately. I'll get myself into trouble if this goes online. In certain respects, he was a prophet with a self-fulfilling prophecy, creating all sorts of hybrids, bringing together the People's Festival, the TMSA events, BBC, art poets, with writers, composers, with the Robertsons, Higgins, Whites, all the travelers and what have you, and letting the sparks fly. He gloried in the multiplicity of Scots society. He used to send me all over the place to see the Avram Greenbaum players singing in Scots Yiddish and putting on plays and all. I mean, he was, and he could sing 100 songs in Yiddish and translate them as well. He had no time for Anglophobia. In a poem to McDermott, he said, if we think our ills come from our the border, we'll never but never march ahead in good order. He respected and loved the Gael, the piping, the poetry, the Sorley MacLeans. He involved himself, as I say, in the ethnic communities, the Italians, the Poles, the Jews, the whole bit. He made a lifelong commitment to the rights and culture of the travellers. To quote Sheila Stewart, one of them, he fed us with a great sense of worth and made us citizens of Scotland. He came and shared with us all that he had. He put us on the map as human beings. Internationally, if you ever wanted anybody to speak about a cause, and Hamish believed in a number of them, Hamish was your man, and I don't know how many people called upon him. His song, The Gilly Moor, so we're getting that, is a tribute to the blacksmiths of Leith, to the blacksmith of Kiev, creating a big folk hero like John Henry, and we'll get John to do it. The Gilly Moor.
The ployer round sae early brought news to tell it fairly o'er all the gilly moor. News o' him yon muckle callan whistling at the smiddy door. Tak your bow, for here's your ballant o'er all the gilly moor. The gilly moor, come awa and geese your blether. Here's a drammel droon the weather. O'er oh, the gilly moor, mere sons o' birk and pine and rowan, jogs and ivans be the score, swapping yams to cow the gowan. O'er oh, the gilly moor. The gilly moor, now's the time the hammer's ready. Hard times I hod them steady o'er oh, the gilly moor.
Lovely stuff. We are winding to a conclusion gradually. Hamish cornered the Corey's folk trio in Sandy Bell's pub in the early 60s, and he said, I have a new song for you that I've written for Nelson Mandela. He said, fine. They were well oiled at the time. Fine, Hamish, send it along. Said, no. You're recording it tonight. Said, we've never seen it. That doesn't make a difference. So he got all of them, dragged them over to the School of Scottish Studies. They were half cut and recorded his Ravonia for Nelson Mandela, which was sent to the freedom fighters of South Africa. And they duly sang it in the field. It was sung before Mandela. Mandela flew across twice to see Hamish. He totally acknowledged that song. It's a typical Hamish song. Spanish Civil War melody in English and Zulu to the good Scots theme of freedom. Just maybe just a wee touch of it. Maybe not do the whole thing because we are running out of time. So we'll do it and then we'll do our final one in a minute. So just a wee bit of Ravonia and you can sing the choruses, which are easy. Roomba la, roomba la, roomba la. Just a wee bit of it, anyway.
They have sentenced the men of Ravonia, rumble, 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 the comrades of Nelson Mandela, rumble, rumble, rumble. He is buried alive in an island, free Mandela, free Mandela. He is buried alive in an island, free Mandela, free Mandela. Therefore feared the mind of Mandela, rumble, rumble, rumble. He is stifling the voice of Mandela, rumble, rumble, rumble. Free him, Becky Goldberg, Sisulu, free Mandela, free Mandela. Free him, Becky Goldberg, Sisulu, free Mandela, free Mandela. The crime of the men of Ravonia, rumble, 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 was to organize farmer and miner, rumble, 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 against Baskap, Shambok and Kiri, free Mandela, free Mandela. Against Baskap, Shambok and Kiri, free Mandela, free Mandela.
It's up to you.
You said a wee bit.
Yeah, just a wee bit. The actual recording Hamish gave to me in a knackered, stoury, dusty box, all cut to pieces. We had to glue it back together, basically splice it back together in studio. But when we got it, we recorded it, and it was amazing. So I have the actual recording. He was a man with a unifying vision, and I quote him, I called myself and call myself a Scottish nationalist, but I've tried to make it clear that a good nationalist must first be a good internationalist. In closing, absolutely. Let me say thanks to the inimitable Dr., to give his proper title, Dr. John Morran over there. Thanks to Dr. Robin Marsack, chair of this, great person. To Nazia Khan, who's in the back somewhere or beyond the back. To Brian Scott, the sound engineer, and indeed to your good selves for turning out. A parting message from Hamish, freedom which has only become man here and there must pass into the mass itself, into the lowest strata of society and become people. We'll close with his The Freedom Come All Ye. Bob Dylan said he wrote the times they are a-changing directly because of Hamish's Freedom Come All Ye. I could tell you a pretty risque Scots story, but I won't, about the Dubliners singing Freedom Come All Ye in an Irish pub. I'll tell you that privately. It Many have argued it should be our national anthem in Scotland. It's a vision of black and white intermediate. I notice a number of folks singing intermediate. Mediate is a hotel group. It's not a Scots word. I keep telling them, intermediate. Are the bairns of Edom eating and drinking in world harmony? Yet it pulls no punches for Scottish conquest in the name of the British Empire. He said, we were not averse to the jackal's pickings either. The Freedom Come All Ye, our final song. Please feel free to join in and sing it. Take it away, John.
Rock the wind, hear the clear day dawn, blast the clouds, hail stark gaudy hour the way. But there's fair not a rock wind blowing through the great glen of the world today. It's a thought that would gather rottens are the rogues that gang gallus fresh and gay. Tag the road and seek other loanings for their ill ploys to sport and play. Nay, mair will their bonny callants merch to war when our braggarts cruisly crawl. Nor we wains frae petied and clachin mourn as ships sailing down the broomy law. Broken families and lands we've headed, will curse Scotland the brave, nae mair, nae mair. Black and white ain't the other merit, mak the vile barracks of the maesters there. Say, come all ye, at hame with freedom, never heed with the hoodies croak for doom. In your house, the bairns o' Edom will find breed, barley, bean, painted room. When MacLean meets with his friends in Springburn, now the roses and geese will turn to bloom. And a black boy beyond Nyanga dings the fell gallows of the burghers doon. Nae mair will our bonny callants merch to war when our braggarts cruisly crawl. Nor we wains frae pitied and clachin mourn the ships sailing down the broomy law. And broken families and lands we've headed will curse Scotland the brave, nae mair, nae mair. Black and white ain't the other merit, mak the vile barracks of the maesters bear.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much. John Morran. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Well, I should have warned you beforehand that there would be a brief time where you could ask questions. Is this still being filmed? Audio recorded. Okay, so you can't ask for those private stories that you're longing to hear about Hamish.
Yes.
I don't think so, but there is a short space for other questions. For questions, and if anybody has one on the tip of their tongue, would they raise their hands? There's a roving mic in the room, and we can get that to you. Is there anybody who would like to ask anything?
Who knows?
Could I
just see? Yes, sorry. Thank you. Could you just speak into the microphone so that people at the back can hear?
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Probably it's a very personal question. What's your one favourite lasting memory of Hamish Henderson?
Oh, that's very, very difficult. Probably some silly memories, quite some silly. I was telling you about one of them. One of the memories was, Hamish was quite a witty character. This is one thing never portrayed, to my mind, in the documentaries. Here I'll get myself in trouble, but it isn't. He was involved in the incipient Scottish Labour Party under Jim Sillars. And so I said, I went to see him and said, Hamish, how are you getting on then with the Scottish Labour Party? He said, well, you might say I'm between Sillars and Charybdis. That's a memory. That's a memory. But he was a character. He really was. He was always on the edge of a laugh. This is something that I don't see portrayed very often. Serious, very serious, but also very funny, very humorous. Quite a character. Yes.
There's a question here. Could you take the microphone?
Mm-hmm. Hamish Henderson was renowned for the antipathy that Lord Reith had for Henderson was well renowned. Yeah. I just wonder what you think the impact would have been if he hadn't been effectively banned from the BBC.
Well, I mean, there are two ways of thinking of this. Sometimes oppression breeds all sorts of interesting reactions. I've often thought about this. A mate of mine put that sort of thing to me one time when I was talking about political opposition. Says sometimes you need something to bounce off, to work again. So there is something. Hamish couldn't stand the BBC for many years for what went on, eventually won through, but in a way it fired his enthusiasm for what he was doing even more. The more they tried to suppress him, the more he felt, no, I've something to get on with. They believed in what he was doing. And he was, to my mind, he was right in so many respects. I say he's not thought much of a philosopher, yet much of what he's written is philosophical. What he has to say about art and the artist, our folk traditions, language, all sorts of things. Very, very important. But yes, that's something. Had he not had that, yeah, he still would have created a great deal, but that gave him something to rub up against and, you know, pounce on, you could say. Yes. Somebody else? Anything?
There's a gentleman here and a lady behind. Thank you.
I knew about Hamish Henderson's work with Granchi, but I didn't know he was one of the first to translate Primo Levi. Did they continue in contact? Could you say a bit about
He certainly continued in contact with so many Italian poets and what have you. He was the first to translate Gramsci in 1946. That's when Gramsci published that poem. I can't say, I don't know if he probably was in touch with him. Certainly he was in Montale, came across to Edinburgh a couple of times, and various other Italian poets. He was a great Italianist, as I say, amongst other things, so that he did stay in touch with the whole Italian coterie of poets and what have you. He was banned from Italy. Well, that's another story. Because he was too outspoken, really, and about certain things that were happening with the government. Yeah, but he stayed in touch with it, yes, with the poets and artists and what have you.
Is there anybody else?
So, yeah, thank you very much for bringing back the voice of Hamish. I used to live underneath his flat at 20 Melville Terrace.
Oh, God.
For a few years in the 70s. When we used to sing a lot of things, he'd knock on the door and come in and said, would you be after having a wee dram for a singer, Davy?
Yeah, yeah.
And I would have to, find the whiskey and give it to him. But we'd sing The Boys of Rivonia, especially after the, which is very relevant till tomorrow in a way, not relevant till tomorrow, match between England and South Africa when the Springboks were here.
Oh, yes.
And we're all demonstrating against them and so on. But yeah. What do you think his voice would be about now? What would he be singing about now? What would he be composing about now?
Take a wild guess. I mean, his central thesis was no Brexit against humanity. That was his central thesis. You know, no. He would have been very, very outspoken about all the things going. For several reasons, and I hate to politicize, and I suppose one can't help but do that in a way. He would have seen, I mean, I'm in a way projecting my mind into Hamish's, but he would have seen very sadly the racist, sectarian, ethnocentric basis of much of what's going on, and he wouldn't have liked it any more than he did back in the 30s. So that's a point. This whole thing of language as well, I mean, he would have been scathing about it. This nonsense of using words like transparency when we simply mean honesty, not transparency, honesty. When we talk about issues, when we mean problems, and I could go on and on and on. The language is rubbish, it's impoverished, it's empty, it is futile, and it's misrepresenting. It's there purposely to distance ourselves from actually what is happening. There's during the 1960s, the American press used to say, and today their Air Force cleared out the infrastructure. And for years, journalists tried to figure out, a number of them, what does that mean? What does that correspond to? Clearing out the meant dropping napalm on civilian populations. That's the problem of language. It's a mask so often, and there are people using it in a very insidious way, I'm afraid. There you have it. Yes.
Just can you hold it to the microphone, comes? Thank you.
I thought Hamish Henderson would have been exposed to John Morran or Pembroke.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you know what his thoughts were about John Morran?
Well, I mean, he was absolutely steeped in it. He was a close friend of Callum Johnston and the Macleans. Not just Sonny Maclean, you know, as a member of that family with Callum Maclean, the Pipers of Razzy. And the Pipers of Barra and all this, but he certainly, he encouraged me myself with my own piping. He was, and I played a good deal of Pibrochen and what have you. He was steeped in Kilmore, as well as the light music as well. And I mean, he would have gone on and on and on with that. To him, it was a classical form of music, which it is. He might have been interested in the fact that finally at the RCS, where I teach, we've actually got a department where the pipes are treated as a classical instrument, and a good deal of that takes place. So, yeah, but he was, and he had his favourites as well, as did Sorley McLean. If you knew Sorley, he would talk non-stop about Pibrochen.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Is there anybody else?
Any brave soul.
There's one here and then one here.
Oh, well, that's good.
So,
to what extent do you think Hamish Henderson is responsible for the sort of contemporary Scottish romanticisation of the Jacobite movement and its sort of, as I might see it, and the kind of way that's switched into republicanism you see in Scottish politics? Maybe don't see in the same English politics.
You're saying the romanticization of the Jacobite movement. Well, I mean, that's conveyed right throughout the centuries in the songs. That whole business with Bonnie Prince Charlie and that, you know, the thousands of songs having to do with it. He would have been interested in it as song and as poetry purely. He wouldn't have been a great fan of Bonnie Prince Charlie. No, particularly. He would have been, but he had a balanced view, like Burns. Certainly saw the Jacobites in a very historically balanced way. He wrote an article, Burns did, to the Edinburgh Evening Courant, saying, "You're not going to tell me," he said, "that the House of Hanover is more just than the House of Stuart. I won't accept. The House of Stuart corrupt and what have you, but don't tell me don't advocate the other side." No. And Hamish would certainly had a very balanced view historically. Yes. Somebody else, yeah. Should be a mic.
Thank you. Thanks very much, by the way, for a fantastic, a really wonderful evening. Yeah. I have a recollection, I think, from Timothy Neate's wonderful autobiographies of something that you mentioned, which was the surrender document for that Hamish wrote for the Italians. And I seem to remember that it was written in such a way to try to help the Italian, whoever was, sorry, I forget the details and the names, but to try and he wrote it in such a way, the language was such to try and help people to not keep on fighting the soldiers when the soldiers were told that they had to. Mm-hmm. I wondered if you could, and the other, so he was very careful about the language that was used to try and help them to stop fighting and not have any more deaths on the Italian side.
Yes.
And also there was something about him trying to organize, find pipers so they could march around.
He did. He organized pipers. He had his own personal army of partisans who marched into Rome, and he wrote some pipe tunes for them and everything else.
And the image that I remember was it was to try to raise morale of the people who had lost. So I thought that was a wonderful, thing.
No, that was Hamish's balanced way of seeing and humane way of seeing things, really. He was always very careful about language of any sort, whether it be Italian or English or Scots or what have you. Very, very careful with his use of language because, like he said in one of his poems, he says, "My language can be my weapon." That's what he says at times. It is my sword. And at times he would use it as, but very, very carefully, very surgically and very decently. But very, very careful about language. He was concerned about it, just as Orwell had been, just as Levy had been, and on, and Pound and several of the others. Yep.
I think we've got time for one more, if somebody has a question.
One more?
No.
What I will say,
go ahead.
Yes,
go ahead. I was just going to ask you about that contrast between the individual artists. So we've been hearing today about Hamish as a figure in himself, but also as part of a creator of communal art. You know,
yes.
He was interested in art that came, that was anonymous, that had no author.
That's true.
And so did it not matter to him that his name was attached to his own work?
He had mixed feelings about that at times. My risque story is a point in fact, but I can't put that on the air, you know. The anonymous side of it, he did admire, but at the same time, Hamish was Hamish insofar as he was a bit of a ham as well, in a good way. He liked performing, and so he wouldn't deny that he'd done something. He wouldn't have wanted that. But he also was happy. Many people thought that his songs were just traditional. Many people think his songs are just traditional, that he didn't write them. He was happy enough with that. At the same time, if you said, that was a great song, Hamish, he smiled from ear to ear. So there's a mix there. He was such a character, as I say. I think that jug reminds me. There was a time when he and Mark Emsley gave a lecture to the students. We're all young students at Edinburgh Uni. And the servitor set up the table and all the bits and pieces for one lecturer. Didn't realize it was Hamish and Mark Emsley. And so he put out one jug of water and a tumbler, you see. And so Hamish walked out with Mark Emsley, and there's just the jug and the one glass. So he takes the glass, he pours, he fills the tumbler, he hands it to Mark Emsley, he takes the jug, and he starts drinking. I mean, that was Hamish. So it was a bit of a ham as well. The students just loved that. I mean, they were engaged the whole time from that onwards. He was mad, in a good way. But also, that mix is there, however paradoxical it's about. Yes.
Thank you.
Very quick one.
Yeah.
Do you reckon
there's
a pub where we can all go and start singing
these
songs?
Yeah. Well, apparently they've arranged for Milne's Bar around the corner for several of us to go. And the one thing I will say, now this is really important. Burns and Guinness were born in the same year, 1759. So if you see me at Milton's Park, please bear that in mind.
Well, I'm not going to offer Fred Freeman a drink right now, but I am going to offer him thanks on behalf of us all this evening. It's been a wonderful evening of song, thanks to John.
You're in the middle.
John.